Welcome to all of the best settings in Warzone and Modern Warfare 3. And when I say all settings, I do mean all. As we're going to go over the best settings across audio, graphics, and controller. I have made videos on these elements all separately before, but some have seemed a little confused on which settings are the latest best available, and where to access other important settings. So I thought I'd group every single best setting option in Warzone right here, so you don't miss a thing. I've chosen all of what I'm going to share here based on improving overall performance and enhancing competitive performance. So essentially tweaking things that will allow us to get more kills and win more games, but not having the game necessarily how the developers intended. So the game is going to look smoother, it's going to look brighter, you're going to hit footsteps a lot easier, and you're going to be able to do all of the important movement mechanics seamlessly. And we're going to start with the controller settings and specifically the button layout. I recommend Bumper Jumper Tactical. Generally with our controller settings, we want to be able to do all of the different movement mechanics and actions in Call of Duty as seamlessly as possible. So that means without taking our fingers and thumbs off the controller. Now, unless you play Claw or you have a paddled controller, you're going to find this really difficult with a standard button layout. For example, if you play Tactical, where your melee and prone are swapped around, you're still going to have trouble jump shotting, since you need to come off the right analog, which you use to aim around and look around, to actually go over to the jump button. Whereas with Bumper Jumper Tactical, it allows us to do things like drop shotting and sliding and diving really easily, just by clicking in the right analog. But then if you want to jump shot or jump over things generally, you just use the left bumper. So if we think about the most famous movement mechanic in Call of Duty, i.e. slide cancelling, you need to use the crouch and prone button with the jump button to do it effectively. Well, using this, you can do it absolutely seamlessly. Now, it's not going to be for everybody, because it is going to take a little bit of getting used to if you don't use something similar already. And for many people, they don't have a lot of time to go through that learning process. A much easier version, which is still advantageous compared to the standard button layout though, is Tactical. So if you don't want to go all the way to Bumper Jumper Tactical, then just Tactical is fine. But just before we get into the rest of the settings, if you're looking to unlock Modern Warfare 3 camos completely legitimately, or play in bot lobbies, get all the best schematics, all the brand new nuke skin, be sure to check out Mitch Cactus. They're the biggest and most reliable sellers with loads of new offerings for Modern Warfare 3, with completely safe and legitimate services. These guys have well over 10,000 verified reviews on Trustpilot, and be sure to use code SPRING for 5% off for a limited time only. Okay, now back to the settings, and then we come down to dead zones. This can help you with two things. One is the responsiveness of your analogs having an actual action on the screen, and the second, it can help you with your aim and stick drift. And by that, I mean when you're not actually touching your controller, but you may start walking forward or your aim may drift to a corner. If that does start to happen, turn up your left and right stick minimums. So in an ideal scenario, these would be on zero, which would mean we have instant responses from our analogs to the screen. But if you get a little bit of drift, put these up by one or two, go back into the game, test it out. If you're still getting drift, go back into here, turn it up again, and then just keep doing that process until it stops. Now going over to aiming, stick sensitivity is super subjective, so personal preference comes into this. For most players, I would recommend between 4 and 7 for both your horizontal and vertical stick sensitivity. These are the most consistent to hit your shots the majority of the time and to be able to track people consistently as well. There's a reason that most pros use between 4 and 7. Now, if that does seem a little slow and you want to turn it up even more, absolutely be my guest. Really, the higher you can go with these, while still being able to consistently hit your shots, the better. A tip I like to show people is to put this on a number you would ideally like to get to, but at the moment it's a little bit tricky, it's kind of hard to hit shots, and then go down to ADS sensitivity multiplier, and then just turn this down a little bit. This would allow you to have the advantages of the higher sensitivity, so you can spin around on a target quickly, but when you actually aim in, you're on a much lower sensitivity, making it easier to hit people. Then for aim response curve type, if you are having most of your gunfights at close range, or you mostly play small maps like Rebirth, I would recommend dynamic. This gives you a slight advantage in the first phases of movement, whereas if you play on bigger maps more often, then linear is going to be your best bet. For ADS sensitivity transition timing, put this on instant. For aim assist, of course, we want that on, and the assist type is absolutely fine on default, although some people may prefer Black Ops. So if you are feeling like aim assist isn't quite working well for you, try out Black Ops. And then as we move over to gameplay, we have automatic sprint. For this, you want it on automatic tactical sprint, allowing you to have the sharpest and most reactive movement possible. So you just move forward on your analog very slightly and you go into the fastest movement. And then for the mantle behaviors, I would largely recommend switching these off. This enables you to be very precise with your movements. So say you're trying to get into a very sneaky jump spot, you're going to need to be very very precise. Or even if you're jump-shotting someone, you don't want to be grabbing onto random things around you. For slide and dive behavior, put this on tap to slide. This makes slide cancelling or sliding into players much, much easier. But you don't want to put it on slide only, because actually diving is still quite useful. For parachute automatic behavior, put this off. By having full control of your chute, you can open it much closer to the ground. For weapon mount exit delay, put this on instant. For interact and reload behavior, put this on prioritize interact if you haven't already. Armor plates behavior, put on apply all. It means you just have to press your button once for it to apply all, so it frees up your fingers and thumbs to focus on movement and things like that. And of course, you can still cancel putting on your armor at any time. And that's actually the last important controller setting. The rest of these aren't too important and are kind of personal choice. So now we're going to move over to the best audio settings, starting with audio mix. Now I recommend using soundbar, even if you don't use the soundbar. In fact, these settings are going to be recommended mostly for people that use headsets. If you are using something else like a home theater system or cinema or even a TV, I would just go with the standard preset settings for those. Now the reason soundbar is a little bit better than headphones and headphone-based boost right now is that the dynamic range and equalization is actually a little bit wider than those settings. And this is really advantageous after that season 4 update, because it means we should be able to hear the depth of sound that little bit better. And considering footsteps are even quieter, we really need that dynamic range to pick up all the different frequencies. With some of these settings, like TV, all of the sounds are going to overlap a little bit too much. So soundbar right now is a perfect option. And then when we come down to volumes, we can edit this further to give ourselves the best chances of hearing enemies. So that means putting our gameplay music volume on 0, turning our dialogue volume right down to maybe even 0 as well, but I quite like it on 30. Effect volume, put that on 100 because that is footsteps and things like that. Cinematic volume, again, you can put it all the way down to 0. I've left it on 6 for just the echoes of cinematics. And then war tracks obviously isn't too important, but that can go down to 0 as well. Elsewhere, I'd recommend turning proximity chats off. The only advantage this will offer is if you're in a Discord chat or something like that. And then when it's on, you can actually hear enemies talking and you know they're nearby. For most of us though, switching it off is fine. And since we're turning the dialogue right down, I would recommend leaving your subtitles on as well, since occasionally operators do shout out quite important information that can be useful, such as enemies firing or throwing grenades and things like that. So having that pop up in text can be useful, but it's kind of a personal choice. Then for mono audio, make sure this is definitely off. This ensures that stereo audio is enabled, so it gives us directional audio to the left and right cup. And then you want to ensure that reduced tinnitus sound is on. Then finally, there's hit marker sound effects. Again, put this on none. You just don't want any more audio tracks competing for the important stuff. So there are all the important audio settings, and now let's head over to the best graphic settings available right now. And the first setting here is on-demand texture streaming. I recommend switching this off. Sometimes streaming those high-definition textures straight to your console can cause a little bit of lag, and occasionally visual bugs. And to be honest, even with it switched on, you don't see huge differences in game. Next up, we have world motion blur and weapon motion blur. Switch these off and we can immediately just see clearer. And the same goes for film grain. For depth of field, switch this off as well. This ensures there's no extra blurring on the screen when we're aiming in. Then for Fidelity FX Cast, I recommend switching this on, but then the strength of this very much depends on your console. On Xbox Series X, I like to switch it up to 90 to maybe 100. I find this sharpens the images and reduces the blurring in the game on Xbox Series X. But on older generation consoles, this might not be as big of an issue, and actually you could end up with something like screen tearing, or just jitteriness. If that's the case, switch it right down to between 0 and 30. Something else to note with this is that the higher you go, you are going to lose a few frames per second. Again, if you're on older generation consoles, you need to take that into account, because you don't have a lot of frames to be playing with. For 120Hz refresh rate, switch that on if you do have the option. This ensures that we're playing at 120 frames per second when possible, so this is only applicable to PC players and newer generation consoles, so the PS5 and Xbox Series X and S. It does, of course, require you to also have a monitor or TV that can actually run 120 frames per second or more as well. For field of view, make sure you've got this on over 100, and that's as an absolute minimum. I personally go 110. This allows us to see much more around us, but do remember that the higher you go with this, you're gonna lose frames per second. There's just a lot more game to process. On top of that, sometimes if you do run 120, it can be kind of hard to see people at distance. Not a huge issue if you only play Rebirth Island, but if you do play some of the bigger maps, it does become an issue. So 110 works well for me. The ADS field of view, put this on affected. This ensures that when we aim in, we're still at the FOV that we've just set here. And then for weapon field of view, put this on wide. As it says on the right, The weapon looks a little bit smaller when it's on wide, so we can just see more of what's around us. For camera movement, put this on least. And then for brightness, I recommend 60, but really the good range I find is between 55 and 65. This, along with the other settings we're outlining here, just makes each map pop that little bit more. And with the Sheikah Island being retired, that's even more the case, since that was kind of the odd one out of the maps. It was a lot darker. For safe area, minimize this as much as possible. This brings the minimap closer to the center of the screen. Then we want to head over to interface, and specifically to color customization. Despite the big season 4 update, I still recommend running filter 2 as the color filter, and putting the intensity all the way up to 100. This, along with all of the other settings, makes the current map set on Warzone absolutely pop. So hopefully this does get things looking a lot better on your setup, and now that we're finished up here, why don't you join me over in this video for the fastest way to rank up weapons in Warzone right now.